So page 10 of your handout, section C, we're now looking at the role of the husband as Paul brings it in the letter. The scriptures have much to say to the Christian husbands. Let's begin reading just two verses that really sums up the great responsibility of the husbands towards what the Lord has entrusted in their hands. Ephesians 5, verses 23 and 25. It says, "For the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her." The comparison here is weighty. It's really weighty. How can I love my wife as Jesus loves the church? How can I do what Jesus did for the church to my wife? So the bar is very high. But I think that it all comes down to love and servanthood. True headship in a biblical sense is not so much the right to rule as it is the responsibility to serve. Men usually think of serving as the wife's role, but God says it's the husband's role. It is my obligation as a husband to look out for the well-being of my wife, to do what is best for her, whatever sacrifice that requires of me personally, to see that her needs are met and that things generally are taken care of for her. In this sense, I can come close to the requirement. And if this is asked of us, it is because it does not come naturally. I see husbands using the concept of headship to get their own ways. It is true that many of us, men, are willing to make some sacrifices before the marriage ceremony while we are courting, but after we conquer, we change. But as Jesus is always after the church and making sure she lacks nothing, so would the husband towards his wife. If time has anything to do with that, we should really increase in our love for our spouse as we increase in the knowledge, in sanctification, in holiness. The two together cannot be separated. Let's look further into the husband's duties to his wife, verse 28 and 29. And here really goes out of the usual way to stress this strong responsibility. So husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no other ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes it and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church. I think there's some kind of irony intended in verse 29. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes it and cherishes it. We men love to pamper ourselves and be pampered. We love to find the table set and garnished with great food when we come home, right? Well, it's okay to eat well and to cherish ourselves, but this love should be directed first towards our wives, not to ourselves. This is where I believe the irony is. And the words, "he who loves his wife loves himself," is so true. We can use it as a gauge. The moment you do not feel right with your wife, look first into yourself. This is what it actually says. Because women will respond to the love they get. From the beginning, from Genesis 3:16, we are told that the desire of the woman shall be towards her husband. If you give her love, she would give it back to you manifold. It's about time, I believe, that you realize this truth. And remember the virtuous woman in Proverbs 31. This is a perpetual escape passage for men. How many times is it cited? They open their Bible to this passage and say, "This is how my wife should be." But little do they realize that Proverbs 31 was written to men. It wasn't written to a woman. This passage is addressed to a son and bids him not to give his strength to a strange woman, meaning not to give the best of himself to a stranger because he has a wife. And Proverbs 31 is inspired by a woman. It's his mother who told him about these things. And she knows what she's talking about. She knows well the heart of a woman. So what happens when you take care of your woman and give the best of yourself? What happens when the man takes care of his wife? His life and the life of his family improves dramatically. See how the woman changes. Verse 12 says, "She does him good and no evil all the days of her life." Verse 15 says, She also rises while it is yet night and provides food for her household. She becomes a superwoman. It is then that the husband will flourish. Verse 23, her husband is known in the gates when he sits among the elders of the land. He succeeds because he first took care of his wife. That's the message here. And this is when the family improves. Verse 28, her children rise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. There's harmony in the family. Things in the house suddenly improve. Why? Because the husband took care of his wife as he should. That's the primary thing, it seems to be. And that brought blessing into the family. Proverbs 31 was not written for women. It is written for a man to see what will happen if their lives, should they take care, if their lives improve, should they take care of their wives as Jesus loves his church. And who is held accountable if something is not going well in a marriage? Who do you think God will first hold responsible? I believe the husband, because he is the head. And as the head, he is going to have to give an account of what happened. We remember that powerful verse in Genesis 5:2. He says, he created them male and female and blessed them and called them what? Adam. God called them both by the name of Adam. He called them both by the name of man. It is not for nothing that even today the wife takes on the name of the husband. There is a wake-up call for a husband to stand and take their role as head of the family very seriously. It is very possible that things are not too good because we do not take care of our wives. This is the simple message here. And it is in this section we find the mystery of the church as the bride of the Messiah. For now, what we see is that our relationship with the Lord is based on the marriage. This is the mystery revealed. As the husband and wife become one flesh, so do we become one with him, as we now constitute his body. This is a wonderful truth we have here. This is why Paul says in verse 32, this is a great mystery, and I speak concerning Christ and the church. We are so tied to our God as a wife is tied to her husband. This is a great blessing that is given to us here. And when we consider marriage itself, Paul says something that is repeated four times in the scriptures, two of which by Yeshua. It is the principle we ought to remember always. Verse 31. It says, for this reason, a man shall leave his wife and his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. I want to tell you that it is hard to find marital problems where the in-laws are not involved. The parents of married children have to understand that marriage is a divine and independent institution, where the husband and the wife are one, meaning that at no time should one be put against the other. We parents love our children so much that when a stranger comes and takes one of them away, we may begin to resent him or her, and the person becomes like a thief. But this is wrong thinking and misplaced love and priorities. The stranger happens to be our child's spouse, and we ought to love him or her as we love our child. Parents should learn to love and to take a step back. And spouses should also learn to take a step back from their invading parents. How many times have we heard complaints of one of the spouse about one of the in-laws always coming home or taking the place of the husband or the wife? That should not be. We are to love and help our parents until the end, but we are to have a balance. That is why we are given these passages here. And before we leave that section, one more word about submission. Submission is really a universal concept. We are all submitted one way or another to someone or to some organization. Let me go right away to the five areas of submission we have in the New Testament. We are at the bottom of your handout, page 10. It says we are submitted to each other. Ephesians 5:21. Says a lot. The Bible repeats over and over that we are to serve each other, to consider the other better than ourselves, as we see it in Philippians 2:3. And now it says to submit to each other. That does not give the right to anyone to bully another or to take advantage of that great blessing. Second is the one we have seen, the wives to the husbands, Ephesians 5, 22. The third requirement to submission is to the authorities, 1 Peter 2:13. Imagine if everyone decided to abide by the law he thought best to him. It would be anarchy. And we will be missing much about the blessings that come from a well-functioning country. Fourth, we have to abide to the authorities of the church. Hebrews 13:17 says, obey those who rule over you and be submissive, for they watch out for your souls as those who must give account. The fifth part wraps it up for us. We have, of course, to abide to God, and we have to abide to the law of God, to the law of Christ. James 5:7 says, therefore, be patient, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, waiting patiently for it until it receives the early and latter rain. We may not always understand all things, but like Aaron, Eli, David, for instance, and many others, we are to use our God-given faith to find the freedom in submission. Let's go directly to section 5, page 12. I would like to spend more time on the armor of God. Since we're jumping a section, the entire five sessions and more will be available for you in written form, free of charge. If you ask for it, you can go on the site of arielcanada.com and ask for it. It'll be sent to you. And it is here where we come to our concluding study of the book of Ephesians. In these short six chapters, we have been given a taste of heaven. We have seen the lower parts of man. We have been revealed that great mystery of our gathering as Jews and Gentiles together, and been told how dear we are to God. We have been told that now we are part of the wonderful body of the only begotten Son of God. Along with this adoption, we are promised a sure and wonderful eternal future where he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenlies in him. Blessing that he says are now lavished upon us. And with all that, he gave us wisdom and insight that we might comprehend these things, so that we may, as Ephesians 4:24 says, put on the new man, which was created according to the very likeness of our God. Now comes the conclusion. Now we are presented with another truth, a revelation in the true sense of the word, where the curtains are lifted and the enemy is revealed. Here we are given another perspective of that other dimension, another reality where we witness an ongoing spiritual warfare, one that has in fact been going on before the creation of man. It began in time past when Satan, who was then a good angel, and when he fell, he dragged with him not only a third of the angels of heaven, but also, it seems, the whole created universe. This is why it is a chaotic state, or most of it is in a chaotic state right now. And we see him in the opening chapters of the Bible. There he was in the Garden of Eden, where he succeeded in triggering man's fall. And we see him all along the history of man and of Israel, always there to cause problems with his hordes of fallen angels. But these will eventually be all thrown into the lake of fire forever. By the word, we know their beginning and their end, and their capitulation is prophesied and assured. But for the moment, Ephesians tells us that we are in the midst of the battle. And prophecies tell us that we are approaching yet another high point of demon activity as we near the tribulation times. While this war is not new, it will, as we go on, increase in intensity. But if there is one thing that this text in front of us is telling us, is that we have nothing to fear. Because of that one truth, that the battle is the Lord's, it's not ours, and he won it already. And this text, we are given directive as to what to do, and how we are to fight this battle until the coming of our Lord, when he takes us up in the air at the rapture. This is why the opening verse begins with a great truth. See what happens, verse 10 of Ephesians chapter 6. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord, in the power of his might. It says, be strong not in your own power, but in the Lord's power, in his might, not ours. Our strength and power are in him. That is the first lesson in our warfare. If we go ahead and think that we have the power to bound and cast demons out, we are not only fooling ourselves and others, but are giving carte blanche to these fallen creatures to fool us as they want. Even Michael the Archangel, the one who will eventually win the war over the forces of evil and force Satan to be confined on earth for a little while, as we see it in Revelation 12, even him did not dare to speak to the evil one or his forces as some televangelists do today. Jude 1, 9 says, "Yet Michael the Archangel, in contending with the devil, when he disputed about the body of Moses, dared not bring against him a reviling accusation, but what did he say? The Lord rebuke you." Michael, in all his might, in all his power, humbly said, "The Lord rebuke you." He didn't say, "I rebuke you." And even stronger than Michael, the angel of the Lord, that is the visible manifestation of God on earth, that is the Messiah himself, also left us an example to follow. It was at a time when the temple was to be rebuilt and ready for the first coming of the Messiah, and Satan, as he always tried to stop the coming of the seed, here in Zechariah chapter 3, verses 1 and 2, we read these very interesting words. It says, "Then he showed me Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to oppose him. And the Lord said to Satan, 'The Lord rebuke you, Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you.'" I find it interesting, extraordinary, that the angel of the Lord here is called Jehovah. And in the Hebrew reads, "Jehovah said to Satan, Jehovah rebuke you." Why use the name of the Lord twice here? Yeshua, in all his divinity, decided not to use his might, but referred Satan to the Father in heaven for rebuke. This throws light to the meaning of the words in Ephesians 6:10. "Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might." The teaching in both passages is the same. It is the Lord's battle. You cannot in any possible way fight these humongous beings. Do you know what an angel looks like? Let's read, if you want, you can read Ezekiel chapter 1. It has a description of these beings. And these are good beings. All you are asked to do is to use the Lord's power. And how are we to fight these terrible forces? The next verse tells us, verse 11. "Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil." Now we are slowly being brought to see what it means to be strong in the Lord. This strength is seen in the coming description of the armor of God. Two important things are mentioned in this verse. First, put on, which simply means that you do not have it on. That means that you need to put it on. Yes, you are saved. Yes, you are sealed with the Spirit of God. But here you are told that you need to do something. You need to put on something. The life of the believer is not over when he accepts Yeshua as his personal Savior. It is then that the battle begins, and your part in the battle is to put on the armor of God. In this command, we might find the answer to a lot of our troubles. Why are so many believers subjected to so many changes of mood, for example? Why do we needlessly worry and even fall into various depressions? Why do we often feel vanquished and spiritually dead? This might be all due to our inability to realize that we have to put on the armor. This is not a small matter. Our whole life on earth depends on that. Otherwise, complete defeat follows. And that brings us to the second point of this verse. First, it is here as if the devil is portrayed as someone observing and waiting to see if we have the armor on. And if we don't, he attacks. It seems that this is what he's waiting for. And unfortunately, we often keep him busy. And when he attacks, he does it in a very calculated manner. This is what we have the word here, vials. And this is the second point. The Greek word for vials is methodia, which does sound like what? Methods. This is where we get that word method. This word means that someone is doing something or carrying something out according to a plan, according to a strategy. This is what he does. He is waiting in wait and plans all his moves. And this plan is especially designed to make each one of us fall. He is well organized. This passage is not given to us to put fear in us. It is so that we might realize this and put on the armor of God. This is as simple as this. This passage is not also here to put, to alarm us of his presence. It's just for us to push us to get into the study of the word. In fact, there are very few passages in the Bible that deal with Satan and his forces, because there is not much to know about him except that he constantly wants to attack. And if we forget to put the armor of God, as we often do, it doesn't mean that the evil forces can come in and do whatever they want. I want you to know that they are still under the watchful eye of Yeshua. All their actions are regulated by him who lives in us through the Spirit. In Matthew 8, if you remember, Yeshua came face to face with a legion of these evil forces. And you know what they told him as soon as they saw him in verse 29. What do we have to do, Jesus, Son of God? They know very well that he is the Son of God. They worked for him before, and they know his strength. And notice that they did not call on their commander, Satan, to rescue them from Jesus, because after all, they know very well that at the end, all knees will bow to Jesus, and that Yeshua is indeed the Lord of Lords. Even James tells us in James 2:19, even demons believe and what? And tremble. This episode in Matthew also shows us that there are dissensions in the enemy camp. They are found already begging the Messiah for mercy. But as far as we are concerned, the command of the Lord is to put on the armor of God so that to have a sane and fruitful life here on earth. And I believe it is for our comfort and assurance that the following verse is given to us, verse 12. We are there given a tour of the enemy camp. We are shown something that we cannot ever perceive with our eyes. See what it says. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the ruler of darkness of this age, against the spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. So you have principalities, then powers, then the rulers of the darkness of this age, then the spiritual hosts of wickedness, four levels of commands. That is very precise. Again, they are very well organized. But why are we given this information? What can we do with this knowledge since we have just been told that the battle is the Lord? It's good to know, but to what avail? What was Satan's and his demons' greatest strategy? It is to make believe that they don't exist, so they will never be put in check. Here in this verse, the forces of evil are uncovered in their formation and in their whereabouts. This is part of warfare strategy. When an army goes to war against another, they need to know where the enemy is and how it is organized. It is only then that they can win the war. From this verse, we know that the forces of God know exactly who the opponents are and where they are. They even know their secretive structure, something they have tried to hide from men from the very beginning, but the scriptures reveal it to us. And all this information is here so that we might not fear, but know that the angels of God have them completely in check. And Satan, who loves to attack incognito, is given in the scriptures 12 names. 12 names, that's a lot for someone who doesn't want to be known. And I believe that it has the purpose of Ephesians 6:12, that we might know that while he's trying to hide his identity and while he is like a roaring lion waiting to fear, to fire, that is, his darts at us, he himself is being watched 24/7. The titles for Satan are the devil, the dragon, the evil person, the angel of the abyss, the ruler of this world, the prince of the power of the air, the god of this world, Apollyon, Abaddon, Belial, and Beelzebul. And the name Satan is a Hebrew word used 23 times in the Old Testament. When translated, it means the word adversary. And so enough is given for us to know that we will be victorious. And in the last verse of this introduction, Paul reminds us again not to forget to put on, one more time, the armor, verse 13. Therefore, Take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Therefore, now that you know all this, take it up, which is a vital thing in our growth. It is in the next verse that begins the description of this armor. Let's read together what this armor consists of. It is only five verses, but five of the most loaded ones in the scriptures. While the components of this armor have been given to us from the very beginning and can be scattered all over the scriptures, what Ephesians does here is that it gathered that for us so that we might see it as a whole. Verse 14 to 18. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end, with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. What this armor is really is, it paints for us a great picture of the Messiah. Notice first these words in the verse. Truth, righteousness, peace, faith, salvation, and the word of God put together, they represent the perfect picture of Yeshua. We are told in John 14:6 that Yeshua said that he is the way, the truth, and the life, as the belt represents the truth. We are told in 2 Corinthians 5:21 that he is our righteousness, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him, as the breastplate of righteousness represents. We have been told in Ephesians 2:14 that he himself is our peace. Is not him that provides faith for us. We are told in Hebrews 12:2, looking into Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, as the shield produces. Is not Yeshua the author of our salvation? Hebrews 5:9, as the helmet provides. Isn't he called the word of God in John 1:1, as the whole armor really represents? As for prayer, he is the one through whom all prayers should be given. As he says in John 16:24, until now you have asked nothing in my name, ask and you will receive, that your joy may be full. This armor is an extension of the verses Romans 13:14 or Galatians 3:27, where we read to put on the Lord Jesus Christ, because the armor is really himself. Or even more precisely, as we see in Colossians 3:10, he says, and having put on the new man, who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created him, we are being changed in him in order to look like him. That is briefly what the armor of God will tell us how to achieve this goal. The armor of God is really composed of seven components. And again, you can see it in the form of the menorah, just like you have it in the screen. Let's look at each one of them. The first one is seen in verse 14. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth. What is the first element of the armor of God? Truth found in the word of God. Here truth speaks of the whole body of truth, of the doctrines of the scriptures. It is the teaching of it. But that first thing that is needed in the armor of God is one that we have to work, of course, to get. Satan is seen in the scriptures as a liar. And the first lesson is that he can be defeated on the basis of truth. If truth is lacking anywhere, the battle becomes very difficult and sometimes impossible to win. Practically, it simply says that all our beliefs should be based on the scriptures. That is the first thing. As a weightlifter wears the belt before he can lift a heavy weight, so we need the word of God before we can engage in a battle. As a Roman soldier who needs his tunic to be held in place by a belt so that his arms and the rest of his body are free to move and to fight, so we need the word of God to freely be at rest and move around well. As Yeshua said in John 8:32, And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. That is the belt of truth. It is a matter of knowing Yeshua. And as Daniel says again, in Daniel 11:32, second part, he says, the people who know their God shall be strong and carry out great exploits. We need the knowledge of God to go forward. And we remember that Satan's first attack on humankind was on the validity of the words of God. He changed, he altered and added to the word of God so that Eve and Adam were confounded and both fell. Has the Lord said, he asked her. If she had her belt of truth, the course of history might have changed. When in Genesis 3:4, the serpent said to Eve, you will surely not die if you ate of the fruit. Had she taken up the armor of God, she would have remembered that God expressly said in Genesis 2:15-17, for if the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. See how our parents fell. We are no better than they. We urgently need to wear the belt of truth. And this is a message that we find all across the scriptures, of course, from beginning to the last page of the Bible, when Jesus warns us not to take off, to add, or even to alter anything that is in the scriptures. You know, Ironside, in his commentary on Ephesians, brings a very cute story told by another Bible commentator from the 1800s, Andrew Bonar. I don't know if you know Andrew Bonar. He wrote a great commentary on the book of Leviticus. So Bonar was speaking on heaven and the great reunion of loved ones over there. And in his eloquent way, he pictured the believer newly come from earth, walking along the golden street and suddenly coming right up against a group of Old Testament prophets. In a moment, he recognized them and said, is this Ezekiel? Yes, says Ezekiel, I'm so glad to meet you. And this is Micah and Zechariah and Obadiah. It's true that we will recognize ourselves in heaven. And then Andrew Bonar said, and just imagine Ezekiel saying, oh, you knew about me, did you? How did you like the book that I wrote? Book? What book? Oh, surely you remember my book. Did you enjoy it? I'm sorry to say I never read it. And then Obadiah would say, and what did you think of my book? Let me see, was this in the Old or New Testament? It seems to me I remember there was such a book. So Bonar concludes, how would you feel to have to meet this man when you never have read your scriptures? We should get busy reading the scriptures. There's far more too much attention spent perhaps on watching TV or reading novels or newspaper, and too little given to the Word of God. It's okay to read a newspaper. It's okay to watch TV if you want, but these things should not take the first place, especially if the Word of God represents a vital part of our armor. This is the first part. The next piece of the armor is also very, very vital to lead a normal life. This is the breastplate of righteousness. This breastplate that the Roman soldiers will wear was made of animal skin on which was attached metal plates to protect them from arrows and swords. It covers the body from the neck to the waist. Today's soldiers have a bulletproof vest. It has the same function. It was for the protection of the individual vital organs, such as the heart. And symbolically, this is what the breastplate of righteousness protects us from. In the scriptures, the heart is the place of what? Of our emotions. It is the place of our feelings. And we understand that Satan, as an accuser, does not only accuses us to God, but he accuses us to ourselves as well. And his aim is so that we condemn ourselves to the point where we cannot think properly and let go of everything. This is what he wants. We may end up feeling defeated, anxious, stressed, oppressed, and even guilty. All of these things need not to be in the life of the believer, because this is especially what the breastplate of righteousness protects us from. I want to tell you that you cannot possibly do the work of the Lord if you are depressed or anxious or carry this feeling of guilt everywhere you go. No non-believers will believe you. This is where the Lord's righteousness comes to play. We cannot combat this through our own righteousness, concerning our own righteousness, what did Isaiah say? Do you remember Isaiah 64:6? They are like filthy rags. Not a nice picture, but the strength of this description is proportionate to the importance of the righteousness that we need to put on, the righteousness of the Messiah. God said in Isaiah 54:17, that sums up well for us this piece of armor, no weapons formed against you shall prosper, and every tongue which rises against you in judgment you shall condemn. This is the heritage of the servant of the Lord, and their righteousness is from me, says the Lord. While this is, of course, spoken to Israel, is applicable to us. See how important the concept of his righteousness is in the scriptures. In fact, in the New Testament, this term is used in one form or another no less than 228 times. When the accuser comes and fills me up with feelings of unworthiness, of defeat, of guilt, I will stand strong because it is not a matter of my own, but of his righteousness. And when we do not have that breastplate of righteousness, there is one thing I would like to mention that usually comes out, is guilt. I remember when I was studying psychology that many psychologists believed that they could trace most of abnormal behavior to guilt. I believe they are right. The breastplate of righteousness is here designed against that. Now, guilt could be our friend, as it could play in the hands of the enemy as well. When we sin, we feel guilty, and this guilt brings us to analyze our problem, to confess our sin to God, and to move on. This we can do based on the righteousness of Yeshua. But it's when guilt becomes stronger in our mind, then it becomes a problem, and one that needs to be dealt with as soon as possible. We can be obsessed with the memory of some past events. And when we brood over these past memories, what we're really telling Jesus is that, you know what, your cross is not enough, strong enough for my worries. What we're telling him is that his righteousness is not that strong. It's silly, isn't it? Once we did something, once we confess it, it is gone forever. Someone has compared these thoughts with those who have lost a leg or an arm. These will often experience what they call phantom limb pain. They will, for instance, feel an itch in the leg they used to have. It is the same when we brood over our past. As far as your new standing in the Messiah, as God is concerned, it's not there anymore. It's gone. Jesus came and died for these very things. They are gone forever, and this is a great blessing to realize and to take hold of. It is at the base of a sane life. We need not to be like the one described in Proverbs 28:1 that says that the wicked flees when no one pursues. No one is after us. The Lord is with us. False guilt brings shame, brings fear, brings anger. Godly guilt will never bring these things. It will release us from the bondage of false speculation. One is based on facts, of course, and the other on feelings. Okay, you have two types of guilt. Feelings can play really bad tricks to our mind. Like Romans 8:1 says, therefore there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, none whatsoever. And one more very important verse before we leave this piece of armor, I want to bring to you 1 Corinthians 11:31. For if we judge ourselves, we shall not be judged. Okay? This is a gold mine of a verse. Do you know what it says? That once you sin, you confess it, and it's gone. Okay? You don't have to bring it back anymore. Gone forever, meaning we need not to feel guilty about it. A believer who is one that has been redeemed, that is, it is a person that completely is freed from any lingering effect of sin. And this is confirmed with this piece of armor. After the belt and the breastplate, the next piece of armor are the shoes. This is found in verse 15. And having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. The Greek word for gospel is the same as the word evangelize or proclaim. We can read it like this, having put on your shoes for the proclamation of peace. There are two things here. First, it speaks of peace, and this is what the word of truth and the belt and the righteousness of the Messiah in the breastplate should produce in the believer. The shoes are the foundation we stand on, and our foundation should be made of the peace of the Messiah. Peace is that one thing that should characterize the believer, and because you have that peace, now you can communicate it to others. You know that people are attracted to those who have peace, who project peace. Once you have enough knowledge, and once you have come to know how to protect yourself from the wiles of the evil one, once you have attained that peace, you are then ready to evangelize. Effective evangelism comes from strong people who know their scriptures. Have you noticed in Psalm 51 that at one point in the psalm, David comes to a conclusion? See the conclusion he comes to in Psalm 51:13. He says, "Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners shall be converted to you." What he's saying is that at this point in the psalm, he can then become an evangelist. What prompted him to come to that conclusion? What did he do the first 12 verses, by the way? He confessed his sin. He recognized that sin was against God first. He recognized many things in the scriptures. By the way, there are so many doctrines that he mentions in the first 12 verses. So he literally, what he did is that he put on the belt of the word and the breastplate of righteousness. Now, he says, I can teach the word of God because he has attained that peace. He was restored. He restored his relationship with God. And once you have put on your shoes and your belt and your breastplate, then you are called to take the shield of faith. This is in verse 16. Above all, taking the shield of faith with which you'll be able to quench all the fiery darts of the evil one. What does the shield of faith represent? This is not speaking about saving faith. It is about the faith that we daily need. This faith speaks of our confidence in God, our knowledge of God, our close relationship with God that we ought to have. By this point, you have come to see things that the eye cannot perceive through faith. No matter what happens, faith assures you that God is sovereign and in full control of any situation. I love to be near people who have the gift of faith. There's a person in our congregation who, you know, do not know much of the Word of God, but he has such a strong faith on Jesus. And so by now you know that you are not walking alone, because the enemy will always try to isolate you and to make you believe that God does not care about you anymore. Faith tells you otherwise. It is an important link to heaven. And I love the term that Paul uses here. The Roman soldiers would have different kinds of shields. And the one used here, Thorios, is a door-like shield, one that protects almost the whole body. We are told that these shields were made so that an entire line of soldiers could interlock them and march into enemy's line. And they could interlock them also in order to protect themselves. Have you seen such a picture? Okay, you have here a turtle formation. I love to think of the body of the Messiah as one entity with different soldiers, each contributing to the Messiah. This is like a church of God here. And the purpose of this shield is to quench the fiery darts of the wicked one. This speaks of darts of fire. They are spoken as fiery because one thing that the wicked wants to do is to bring us into a state of panic. His aim is to put fire in our senses so that we become irrational and do irrational things. But these darts are easily recognizable. Remember that passage of 2 Timothy 1:7 that sums up well this shield. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. So when you are in a state of panic and fear and you are agitated, remember it is not from God. Take on the shield of faith and these things will eventually disappear from your life. I read also the other day an interesting illustration about faith. For centuries, the islands of New Zealand were unpopulated. No human had ever set foot on them. Then the first settlers arrived. They were Polynesians from other Pacific islands who had sailed hundreds of miles in outrigged canoes. The Polynesians came with the purpose of settling in New Zealand. How did they know the land was there? How did they know they would not simply sail across empty seas until food and water ran out and they would perish? The Polynesians had known for centuries that land was there because their voyagers had seen a long white cloud on the distant horizon. They knew that when a cloud stayed in one place over a very long period of time, there was land beneath. They called the land, New Zealand, the land of the long white cloud. Faith is like that. We are not voyaging to a mysterious and strange place. Do you know that Jesus is already there, preparing a place for us? We are not journeying in an unknown future. Yeshua is there also. He's preparing our eternal future. This is what faith tells us. It is a conviction that is planted in our hearts by the Spirit of God. It is not a mere guesswork or chance of superstition. The next piece of armor is the helmet of salvation that speaks of assurance of one's salvation, and this is very important. Considering the battle a believer is called to fight, what this helmet does is that it tells him that there is no way possible that he can lose the war. It speaks of our eternal security. It gives us the confidence that no darts, no missiles can pierce through the helmet. And to doubt our salvation is again to tell Jesus that his work on the cross was not powerful enough for my sins. Many use the argument as a seeming appearance of humility. I'm not good enough for salvation, but no one is. And this is not the point here. Our assurance is based on the finished work of the Messiah, not on one's changing feelings. And what is next component of the armor? Verse 17, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. It really begins and ends with the Word of God, but it is somehow different. The word here is not logos. It's a synonym. The other is rhema. Rhema is that which is spoken, a sentence, a saying, a speech, or a declaration. In the context, I would see it as the application of the truth, the application of the logos that is represented by the belt. It is the doctrine seen applied as the sum of all the other components of the armor of God. It is the result of the power of the logos or the memra. And it is the only offensive weapon. It is a very powerful weapon, of course. Yeshua used it, if you remember, three times again to put away Satan at his temptation. And there we see James 4:7 in fulfillment. This passage is the only one, by the way, in the law of Christ that is given to us concerning our fight with the devil. See what it says. Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee away from you. It works with Yeshua. It does surely work with you if you use it. And the last thing mentioned is prayer. See verse 18. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Prayer, as the word, should be ever present in our lives. Day after day, the moment you forget to pray, you are putting down your protections. Prayer is second nature to the believer. One cannot conceive a life with the Lord without prayer. There are two kinds of prayer, right? Prayers that we do when we jog and when before we pray and so on. But there's other prayer that is very important that I believe where the Lord asks us to go into our room and to close the door and to have this conversation with him. And what is this thing that Paul wants us to pray about? Notice what he adds at the end of the verse. For all the saints. For all the believers. Ephesians is about us and the congregation we belong to. And Satan will always try to cause dissension and disunity within our midst. But he won't succeed if we put on the armor of God. And all of the armor of God is only complete when all its components are used. To conclude, I would like to repeat the blessing of Paul in the last verse of this great, great letter. Grace be with all those who love our Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity. Amen. May the Lord bless you all.